Hi, welcome to Classic Album Sunday. I'm Tina Edwards and I've been part of the Classic Album Sundays family for a few months now, which is an absolute pleasure. My first one was doing David Bowie's Heroes, and it's such a beautiful platform and a fantastic vessel for us to immerse ourselves in albums that we might know and love already, or discovering something new for the first time. I hope that the album I've chosen to talk to you about today is either something that you already adore or something that you're going to grow to really, really like. And I'm really excited to share with you Cocteau Twins' Heaven or Las Vegas. Before we dive in, I just want to shout out to all of the amazing key workers, NHS staff that are doing spectacular things right now. And I hope that we all give them the heroes, welcomes, applause, celebrations that they all deserve when we do have the chance to celebrate with them after all of this. But meanwhile, I hope that all of you are keeping safe and well and that you're looking after your spirits. So as we dive into this, we're going to kind of just explore the record a little bit. I'm going to tell you a little bit about it. And then afterwards, in about 10 minutes time or so, I'd love for you to go to a space where you can immerse yourself in this record. It's just under 40 minutes long. And if you can find an area where you are not going to be disturbed, where you can just soak into it and yeah, just shut your eyes and just immerse yourself in it. Maybe you'll be cooking, or perhaps you'll be just staring at a candle. I don't know. Making sure that you're just relaxed, whatever you're doing, and can give your unconditional attention to the record. That would be really kind of familiar with what the concept is already. So without any further ado, I want to introduce you to this fantastic record. It's a kind of a common misconception that the Cocteau Twins are actually a trio. Obviously, with twins, you might think that they're a duo, but they're made up of Robin Guthrie on guitar, Will Heggie on bass, who was later substituted by Simon Raymond, and then Elizabeth Fraser on vocals, who for me, it's just a goddess of the voice. She will probably be my main focus in what we talk about here, just because she's pretty much, alongside Bjork, my all-time favourite vocalist, and I hope that you'll enjoy her voice as much as I do. I don't really remember how or when I first heard Cocteau Twins, but what I do know is that I am familiar with their music as much as I am my arms or my legs. Why Elizabeth Fraser's sort of nondescript folk poetry warms my blood and raises my frequency, I'm not completely sure that I can simplify it. But each time I listen to them, it feels like I am just creating a moment ripe for an epiphany. I know I'm not the only one as well. And if you're listening to this and haven't heard their music yet, like I said, then I'm really excited for you. I wish I could kind of nestle into your nerve endings for your first listen. So the Cocteau Twins' Heaven or Las Vegas is a visceral masterpiece that further cemented their place as pioneers of dream pop. And from the Scottish industrial town of Grangemouth came the purveyors of some of the most progressive electronic music to come out of the UK in the 20th century. Music that was otherworldly and still to this day is incomparable to any other act, in my opinion. In terms of critical reception, Heaven or Las Vegas was named by Enemy as one of the best albums of 1990. And retrospectively, The Observer featured the record on a list of the best 100 British albums ever made. In 2018, Pitchfork ranked it first on its lists of 30 best dream pop albums. And throughout its 30 years of existence, Heaven or Las Vegas just hasn't dated. Anyway, critical reception to the side, that's not what it's all about. The record is the Cocteau Twins' sixth studio album and the final one to be released on 4AD Records before they moved to Fontana Records. Now, the label are also known for putting out music from a lot of indie artists like Grimes and The National. So on Heaven or Las Vegas, it's the first time that Elizabeth has used words that can actually be deciphered as English. Despite being called the voice of God by journalists. She carried a lot of anxieties and stage fright throughout her career. Now, Madonna loved the Cocteau Twins. Prince wanted to sign them. And she also had an intense friendship with Jeff Buckley as well, which was sparked with an infatuation with each other's voices. She was actually recording Teardrop with Massive Attack, by the way, when she discovered the news about Jeff's tragic drowning, and suggested that the song is kind of about him. So anyway, with all this, Elizabeth was always wary of using decipherable lyrics, and she favoured words from foreign dictionaries and made-up words too. So when Heaven on Las Vegas came out 11 years after the band was formed, it was a huge revelation for fans because suddenly we had a fuller idea of Elizabeth's imagination. The words are still tricky to make out, but it's kind of more possible to understand a little bit of what she's saying. And possibly it was more bearable for Elizabeth to sing them aloud, given that they're still a little bit mysterious to understand. But now there is something to be interpreted on this record more than ever before. So in 2005, we were expecting the Cocteau Twins to headline Coachella and to embark on a reunion tour. And even though the rumoured amount for reforming was £1.5 million per musician, it seemed like no amount of money could make it comfortable enough for Elizabeth Frazier. It didn't go ahead, as Elizabeth couldn't bear to do it. And the Cocteau Twins had split in 1997. And the reason it might have been unbearable to get back on that stage is because the breakup was driven by another breakup of another kind with her partner, Robin Guthrie, the guitarist. They were lovers until 1993, and together they had a child. He was born just before Heaven or Las Vegas. So Elizabeth and Robin's baby had been born the year before, and it kind of represented a bit of hope for their long troubled relationship. But the relationship sadly became even more strained, accented by the fact that Robin had serious issues with drugs and alcohol, which he's spoken about in a lot of interviews since. And he did later seek treatment. So for me, Heaven or Las Vegas is Elizabeth at her most vulnerable and confessional and open-hearted. And that might suggest that this album is dark or hard to listen to, hard to digest. But for me, it's actually the opposite. And I think it is for a lot of her fans as well. It's transfixing. It's otherworldly, which is a word I'll probably use a lot during this, but it feels so applicable. And as the title suggests, it's just heavenly. For me, it's a very visual album. I'd like to share with you guys actually some short stories that I've been writing inspired by each of the tracks on the album. For now, they're kind of personal, but I might share one in the near future. So listening to Heaven or Las Vegas, it makes you feel as though Cocteau Twins are kind of just playing a single instrument. And I'd love to see if you agree with that kind of statement. The music moves as one body. And if you were to play just a couple of seconds of one of their tracks, you'd be able to tell exactly who it is, which I think makes them one of the most distinctive acts out there. Heaven or Las Vegas is credited as the Cocteau Twins' greatest album by many people. Although if you like this, you'll be able to float into their world in any of their other releases because there's such a good chunky back catalogue for you to dive into. They create a sonic world like no other, where punk and goth and ambient and pop and rock all kind of flirt with each other and make perfect sense. So like Pitchfork said back in 2014, when they retrospectively reviewed their album, they said, if punk had chased beauty instead of glorious ugliness, if goth had emphasized light rather than fetishized darkness, those movements might have sounded like the Cocteau Twins, who had contemporaries, but no real peers. For me, Robin Guthrie's sort of aqueous guitar effects create the illusion of floating somewhere that's characteristic to Cocteau Twins. And Elizabeth's voice, to me, is up with one of the greatest voices or melodicists of all time. As you listen to this album, I recommend that you shut your eyes, roll with whatever images or visions might come to you. As I said at the start of this, it's just under 40 minutes. So I'd love for you to play it, come back here and share with me what you think of the record. It's been a real honour to share this with you. There are some artists who create a world of escapism with their music. And for me, this is the richest world to be found. It's one of the most listened to albums that I have. And quite often I go through periods of playing it several times a day. Presenting this album to you really does mean a lot. So thank you for watching. So 4AD reissued the album alongside their previous release, Bluebell Knoll, back in 2014. And if you don't enjoy, or if you don't, sorry, own the album, but you enjoy it, then perhaps you'll consider supporting the music by getting a copy of your own. So again, thanks for joining me. I really hope you find something that you love about the album. I will be here to chat in about 40 minutes or so on the comments. So if anybody wants to share their thoughts with me after listening, I'll be here. But for now, enjoy.